Hello everyone, welcome to the assessment questions of Para Completion. Before we get down to solve each of these assessment questions, I would like to request a couple of things. One, I am assuming that all of you have already seen the intro lecture for Para Completion. For the ones who have not, I request you to go back to that intro lecture for Para Completion and then come back here. Secondly, I would like you to pause the video while you're doing a question. Try it out on your own because this is one of the most intriguing areas and the ones where people make the most mistakes. Once you're done with your explanation, then check out the solution and see how our thought processes would match. Let's start off with the first assessment question. Now it says, each of the following questions has a paragraph from which the last sentence has been deleted. From the given options, choose the sentence that completes the paragraph in the most appropriate way. Okay, so I'm just gonna quickly look through the question and figure out what's the issue. It says, most people at the first consultation take a furtive look at the surgeon's hands in the hope of reassurance. Prospective patients look for delicacy, sensitivity, steadiness, perhaps unblemished pallor. On this basis, Henry Perron loses a number of cases each year. Generally, he knows that it's about to happen before the patient does. The downward glance repeated, the prepared questions beginning to falter, the over-emphatic thanks during the retreat to the door. So what it tells me essentially is that most of the people kind of look at the doctors in a way that gives them a sense of reassurance. But that kind of is not happening with this guy, Henry Perron, because he tends to lose a number of cases each year. And what is even more interesting is he knows that it's about to happen. So he kind of senses why certainly people would leave him and he would lose that case. And some of the reasons why he assesses that is because of these characteristics, and that's how it ends. So the last line typically should give a conclusion in terms of how Henry Perron would feel about it, or something to do with how you can end this paragraph without getting into too much more additional details. Let's get into the questions. If you look at the option number one, it says other people do not communicate due to poor reasons. You're assuming that some people do, which is not given, so that's gone. Second says, other patients don't like what they see but are ignorant of their rights to go elsewhere. Now, rights to go elsewhere is out of scope. I mean, whether you have rights or not is not what is mentioned, so that's also gone. But Perron himself is not concerned. Now, this could be an answer because he knows that it's about to happen. So, ending it by saying that Perron himself is not concerned, because most of the meaning is already covered before this. So, this could be an answer. Let's park it for now. If I read the fourth one, it says, but others will take their place, he thought. Now, he thought assumes that there is some thought given before. See, he thought also assumes that there is some thought given before, and I have no context of a thought, so that's gone. Last option will be, these hands are steady enough, but they are large. Again, has no context to the fact that he will lose the case. So from that context, this also do not make sense. So only one can make sense, because he knows about to happen, and also for the fact that but Perron himself is not concerned can be taken back to the passage. So a relation, direct relation back to the passage, is extremely important, as we have discussed in the previous concepts. I hope this question is clear. Third is the answer. Let's move on to the next one. So in the next question, it says, what happens to our brain as we age is of crucial importance, not just to science, but to public policy. By 2030, for example, 72 million people in US will be over 65, double the figure in 2000, and their average life expectancy will likely have edged above 20 years. However, this demographic time bomb would be much less threatening if the elderly people were looked upon as intelligent contributors to society rather than as dependents in long-term decline. So what it essentially shows is the fact that when an increasing number of people are over the age of 65 or above, we are considering elderly to be not as intelligent contributors. So we are not considering them as intelligent contributors, rather we are considering them as dependents in the long-term decline. And that is the question that the author is asking, that what happens to our brain as we age is of crucial importance, not just to science, but to public policy. So we have understood two things here. One is that the increasing number of population, so there is an increase in 65 plus age, and number two, elderly are not considered to be intelligent or intelligent contributors to the society. So these are two things which we have understood, and it kind of completes the meaning till here. So as we already know that if it completes the meaning, then typically the last line would kind of encapsulate the meaning. So if you look at an encapsulate or summary statement, that kind of a statement should be the last line. Let's look at some options. The first one says the idea that we get dumber as we grow older is just a myth. So dumber is again too harsh. It's too harsh and it is beyond the tone. So tonal expression do not match. Tonal expression do not match. And that's one characteristic we have done in paracompletion. So that's not the answer. It is time we rethink what we mean by aging mind before our false assumptions result in decisions and policies that marginalize the old or waste precious public resources to remediate problems that do not exist. This could be an answer because essentially it says that it's time that we rethink how we think about the aging mind, and that's typically the idea here also. And it says that before our false assumptions, and what's our assumption is that they are not intelligent contributors. So some way you can take it back to the passage. This could be an answer. We'll park it from here. C says many of the assumptions scientists currently make about cognitive decline. So the whole fact is not about cognitive decline, but from a mindset point of view, especially with respect to the old people, with respect to old people. So it just says cognitive decline is seriously flawed. It seems that every decision that we made is flawed, which is not correct. So the problem that is there is only with respect to the old people. So this is a generic trap. It's a sentence which points out a problem in a very generic way. So that's the wrong answer. Using computer models to simulate young and old brains, Ram Askar and his colleagues, this you don't know who he is, not given in the passage, therefore this is gone. Right answer has to be B. It's a very good question. I request you to go through the solution again to understand why the answer is B. Let's go to the next one. So the next question talks about the real threat from ISIS is not a territorial but ideological. So the threat is ideological. It says fighters are flocking to the fledgling caliphate. Caliphate refers to the ISIS here. Because they are attracted to the notion that violence and bloodshed can create a space of totalitarian homogeneity. Which means people are joining ISIS because they believe that the violence that ISIS gets into can create them a space of something authoritative. It is not simply the attraction of a particular religious interpretation. ISIS offers a counter narrative to nationalism, which means ISIS gives them a different ideology to work with, a different perspective is what we understand. And that's what is attracting people, and that attracts people to join ISIS. That's typically the broad idea. The society that the caliphate has created is multi-ethnic, transnational, and fully conversant in the latest technology. So basically from a very high level, the question talks about the fact that the threat of ISIS is typically ideological. People are flocking to there, join these kind of enemies, these kind of institutions is because they believe that violence can have a cure for everything, and because of which that gives them a new ideology to work around. So that's what is attracting a lot of people to ISIS. And it ends the passage. Let's look at some options. We may well look back at the first year of Islamic State and wax nostalgic about our comparatively first year. Very specific, not really matching with the overall scope, doesn't match with the scope. So it's gone. Second says, and yet it also offers a very specific historically grounded identity. That could be an answer because it gives them a different perspective to join ISIS, something different to what they have been used to. And that kind of goes back to the passage as well. So could be an answer. C says, however, ISIS is not a state. States are part of the world that ISIS rejects. So again, it's very out of the context. And since it's out of the context, we'll not take that as the answer. It has a 100-year plan, very, very unnecessary, unknown element, which you are not very sure. And because unknown elements have to be eliminated, we'll eliminate D, we'll eliminate C, we'll eliminate A. B has to be the answer because it goes back to the passage in terms of giving them a new perspective as to why they should join ISIS. I hope this explanation was clear. Let's go on to the next question. Let's look at the next question. It says, Federer's fifth Grand Slam win prompted a reporter to ask whether he was the best ever. Federer is certainly not lacking in confidence, but he wasn't about to proclaim himself the best ever. The best player of this generation, yes, he said, but nowhere close to ever. Just look at the records that some guys have. I am a minnow. And the question ends. Now, this is a very interesting question. It has come in CAT 2005. So basically what it says is somebody asked Roger Federer as to, after winning the fifth Grand Slam, as to, are you the best ever? He says, maybe best of this generation, but nowhere close to what the world has ever seen. I am a minnow. And the question ends. So if you look at the way to solve this problem, bringing an unknown element would not really help. You'll have to summarize it in such a way that the point of being best versus best ever kind of gets reiterated. Let's look at some options. He says his win against Agassi. I'll just change the pen. His win against Agassi, a genius from the previous generation, contradicts that. So again, when you look at a specific example and that contradicts a very generic sentence, that is never a right logic. So specific sentences can never negate a generic sentence. So that's gone, because here the whole sentence is about whether he's the best of the whole generation. One match, losing or winning, is not really going to matter anyway. So first is not the answer. Sampras was as humble. So this brings an unknown element of Sampras not given in the passage. He's more a minnow to his contemporaries. That's very vague and doesn't give me any context to play around. The difference between the best of the generation versus the best ever is a matter of perception. And that looks like a very answerable kind of a sentence, because it brings out the difference between the fact that Federer considers himself to be the best of his generation, but the best ever, these kind of things are entirely a matter of perception. And having said that, you can plug the statement here and that would end the whole paragraph, making it a very comprehensive one. I hope this solution was clear. Let's move on to the next one. The next question says, most firms consider expert individuals to be elitist, temperamental, egocentric, and difficult to work with. So who are they considering the expert individuals to be elitist, temperamental, egocentric, and difficult to work with? Force such people to collaborate on a high-stake project and they just might come to fisticuffs. So fisticuffs essentially here refers to the fact that the performance of these people gets diluted or becomes bad. So the performance becomes poor. Even the very notion of managing such a group seems unimaginable. So most organizations fall into default mode, setting a project teams of people who get along nicely. So it's a very interesting question. It says that most firms consider the expert people to be full of ego and temperamental, and it's very difficult for them to work with normal people. Because of which, today organizations are falling into this default mode of setting up project teams of people who get along nicely, rather than the fact that whether they are the highest in their pedigree. So that's what the question is. The result, however, is disastrous. Now, this is too extreme. We don't know. There is no context which suggests the extremity of the sentence. So this can't be the answer. The result is mediocrity. Could be because you're not taking the elitist here. You're just taking people who can just get along nicely. So this could be an answer. The result is creation of experts who then become elitist. So there is no reference in the passage which suggests that. No reference that suggests that. So there's no reference which says that mediocre people will turn into elitists. So again, that's gone. Naturally, they drive innovations. They won't, because innovations will be driven by people who get along nicely is an assumption you would have made to come to this point, which is not again given. So for this point to have worked, my assumption would have been that innovations are always done by people who get along well, which may or may not be true. So this may or may not be true, and hence this whole assumption is flawed. So this is also wrong. The answer is option number 2, that the result is mediocrity. I hope this solution was clear. Let's go to the next one. Let's look at the next one. It says blank. So we'll have to fill the blank here. So it says, for example, two of the world's best loved and most abiding narratives, The Lord of the Rings and the Narnia series, invoke values that were familiar in the Middle Ages but are generally considered repulsive today. So basically, these two series are invoking values which normally do not invoke, which do not come as normal. Considering these stories is disorder in these stories is characterized by the usurpation of rightful kings or the rightful heirs. Justice and order rely on the restoration. We find ourselves cheering the resumption of autocracy, the destruction of industry, and even in the case of Arnia, the trump of divine right over secular power. So if you just read the last two lines, it gives you the fact that people are believing or cheering for unconventional things which they wouldn't normally cheer for. And that for me is the context which should fit the first blank. So let's look at the first option. It says stories that possess narrative fidelity, reflecting the way we expect humans and the world to behave, are the ones we like the best. So narrative fidelity is not the actual point of the passage, so that's gone. Stories can be so powerful that they sweep all before them, even our fundamental values and beliefs. And this could be an answer, because everywhere people are believing and cheering in something which they normally would not. So that kind of powerful stories that change our fundamental values, logic fits back to the passage, so could be an answer. C says stories that resonate powerfully with the narrative structure, our minds are prepared for triumph over facts and evidence. So this is again a very generic argument. Doesn't really talk about the fact that people do not believe in something, are believing in it today. So although kind of close option, but I'll eliminate that. If a narrative is simple and intelligible, resonating with our deep needs. So not necessarily it has to resonate. I mean, if it resonates, then you wouldn't be cheering for something unconventional. So this is gone. So the only answer, which looks like a huge possibility, has to be option B, and that is the right answer. I hope you understood this. Again, it's kind of a difficult question. I request you to go through the solution again to kind of get the finer nuances of this question and understand the question better. Let's go on to the next. Let's look at the next question. Now again, the blank has to be filled in the first part. So the logic of filling the blank in the first part is understand the context in the second part. So we will try and understand the context in the second part, and corresponding to that context, we'll fill the blank. Let's read. It says, in his book, The Republic, Plato proffered a parable in which Socrates celebrates the solitary philosopher. In the allegory of the cave, the philosopher escapes from the darkness of an underground den and from the company of other humans into the sunlight of contemplative thought. Look at the way the sentence is written, sunlight of contemplating thought. He's running away from people, but he still considers it to be a sunlight of contemplative thought. Alone but not lonely, the philosopher becomes attuned to her inner self and the world. In solitude, the soundless dialogue which the soul holds with herself finally becomes audible. So it's a hard passage to understand, but what comes out very clearly is the fact that even if you are alone, that is not considered to be a problem. In fact, being alone leads you to self-discovery. So that's typically a broad level of understanding of the passage. So anything which will talk around these patterns should be the first option, should be the first sentence to be fitting here. First one says, philosophers have long made a careful and important distinction between solitude and loneliness. Second says, solitude is a state of mind essential to the development of an individual's consciousness and conscience. So it just gives you a definition of solitude, which is not really what I'm looking at. Philosophers have long made a careful and important distinction between solitude and loneliness. And this kind of gives you that point to go back, because even being alone, you are discovering, so you are being in solitude. So that logic kind of fits here. Let's look at the third one. Philosopher recommends solitude in short bursts. So point of recommending is not given. So that is gone. If we lose our capacity for solitude, our ability to be alone with ourselves, then we lose our very ability to think. So this option is too far-fetched. I mean, just from a concept of solitude, the whole idea if we are not in solitude will lead to the fact that we lose our ability to think is extremely far-fetched. Therefore, A has to be the right answer, because it brings out that distinction of the fact that even if you're alone, you might not be alone and you might be in solitude, which will lead you to self-discovery. So another good, interesting question. Again, hopefully you should go through the solution one more time to understand it slightly better. Let's go to the next one. So next one says birth rates have fallen dramatically and voluntarily. And that's, so the points to understand here is, one, the fall has been dramatic and the fall has been voluntary. Coercive birth control pill, so including paying people not to have babies, was discredited and abandoned years ago. Nearly two-thirds of the couple in poor countries now use birth control. And not because some patriarchal Westerner told them to. Which means people are taking birth control out of sheer choice. And that also kind of corroborates the fact that it is done voluntarily. In the 1970s, the government of Bangladesh offered people in the Matals region low-cost contraceptive supplies and advice. Birth rates promptly fell well below those of neighboring regions. So Bangladesh extended the service nationally and its birth rate plummeted from 6 children per woman to 3. So it seems to be a pretty easy sentence to understand from a meaning perspective. It says that the birth rates have fallen and the fall is one, it's dramatic, and two, it's voluntary. It's voluntary and Bangladesh is helping these people to ensure that their birth rates decrease, and as a result, the birth rates have plummeted from 6 children per woman to 3. So the meaning is pretty clear, which means the answer again has to be a summary or anything which summarizes this. Population gone has already gone off. The population bomb has already gone off. Population bomb, new phrase, and all looks to be a bit unknown, so we'll eliminate this. Given the choice, people want fewer children. Now this could be an answer, because people want fewer children can go back to the point of being voluntarily. Given the choice is because Bangladesh government is offering people the supplies. So this could go back to the passage, can be a prospective answer. Third says governments want fewer children since their own life expectancy falls. So this is unknown and this is not given, so there is no reference to go back. So if I have to have a reference, it has no reference. Even though birth rates fall, there is a lag, which means population keeps going for decades until birth and death rates even out. So this is absolutely vague and out of context. Birth rate, death rates, that is not compared here. So answer has to be 2, which says given the choice, people want fewer children. And that summarizes the fact that people are doing it voluntarily and they are happy to do that because the government is also kind of giving them the choice to do that. I hope you have understood this point. Let's go to the last question. It says that Jawaharlal Nehru seemed an unlikely candidate to lead India towards his vision. Under the cotton khadi he wore in deference to the dictates of Congress, he remained a quintessential English gentleman. So he was different than, he was an unlikely candidate because he was not wearing khadi, he was wearing like an English gentleman. In a land of mysteries, he was cool, rationalist. The mind that had exulted in the discovery of science never ceased to appalled by his fellow Indians who refused to stir away from their homes. He was a publicly declared agnostic. So agnostic are people who doubt the existence of God in the most intensely spiritual area in the world, and he never ceased to proclaim the horror the word religion inspired in him. So he did not like the fact, he did not propagate religion. Nehru despised India's priests, sadhus, chanting monks and pious sikhs. So from understanding the question, it seems that the whole passage talks about the differences and draws out how unlikely he was as a candidate to lead India towards his vision, because he was different in terms of his thought process. So thought was one factor, the way he dressed up, unconventional in his ways, and the fact that he did not believe in religion or God made him a very unlikely candidate to lead India towards this vision. And he also despised India's priests or sadhu. So that kind of gives you an overall personality trait of Jawaharlal Nehru. So the answer has to be a combination or a encapsulation of that whole characterization. Let's look at first one. It says, and yet the India of those sadhus and superstitious haunted masses had accepted Nehru. Haunted masses had accepted Nehru. You don't know. This is, you don't know. So we, it's kind of an unknown. So we don't know this. So this is gone. They had only served, he felt, to impede her progress. They had only served. If you look at the last line, it says, Nehru despite India's priests, her sadhus, her chanting monks, and so he despised her. They had only served, he felt, to impede her progress. So they refers to these sadhus, monks, and so on. This her refers to India. And this could well be an answer, because this kind of goes in continuation to the last line and kind of serves well. So we'll park this for now. The Mahatma had made it clear. So this is very unknown to me. I have no reference of Mahatma. Nehru's heart told him to follow Mahatma. Again, very unknown. No reference. So this is gone. This third is gone. This has to be the right answer, because it kind of takes it parallel from the last line, saying that these sadhus and monks only serve to impede India's progress. And that is also very parallel to what his thought process was. I hope you have understood how to do these kind of questions. Mostly these questions will be tricky in nature, but always remember to take into considerations the points that we have discussed, eliminate the unknown, and as much as concerned, stick to the scope of the passage, and hopefully you should get the answer. This is quite a difficult topic to master. I request you to at least practice a lot of questions on para completion and get back to us in case you have any doubts. Thank you so much for watching this video. Thank you.